in the fundamental values of faith and family and friendship and, of course, football. So he's really enjoying the experience.
Can you say, how has he done since he's gone with Denver? I mean, it seems like everyone in the media thinks that he should be starting. I think he should be starting. But the general consensus is that this is perhaps the best, other than Dak Prescott, quarterback out of this 2016 class. How did we get it to where the class was so mixed up, where you have the top two injured and not starting, Paxton, you know, close to starting, and then Dak Prescott starting for the Cowboys?
Well, I think Jared Goff is going to end up being a fine quarterback. Again, you have a situation where a veteran is much more aware of the offense. Jared will be just fine. Carson Wentz is hurt, so that's his situation. And they have a much more experienced Sam Bradford ahead of him. Dak Prescott's starting for one reason, because Tony Romo got hurt, as he has a number of different times. And I wouldn't make too much of any of these preseason performances, because you never know whether they're playing against the first, second, or third team. And essentially, they're doing it athletically, running around and doing it on their arms. So Dak Prescott's now been anointed to the Hall of Fame based on a couple of preseason games. I don't know if they really need a career for him. He can just go straight to Canton. But the reality of the NFL season will take place. But he's looked good. And I think that looking at the beginning of the 2016 season is illusory. What really is important is we'll look back on it in a couple of years and see how these players have matured.
Let's talk about the rest of your clients. You've got a great tight end on Northwestern, by the way. And how's he doing?
So, first of all, you have Daniel Lasco from Cal.
Yes.
Who's got a great first step and has really played well. And I think he's hell on wheels on special teams. So he's going to make the team. He suffered a little concussion last week, but they've liked him a lot. So he'll be fine. There's one last cut left to go, and it'll happen this weekend.
And he wound up with the Patriots, right?
No, Daniel Lasco's with the Saints.
That's right, the Saints.
And Danny Vitale, who probably will set the Guinness Book of Records for playing the most positions. He's, I call him a robo-back because he can play fullback. He can split out as a tight end. He could probably split out as a flanker. He can block, he can run from scrimmage, he can catch passes. He's doing just fine. We have a player, Jonathan Woodard, who's on IR with Jacksonville. We have a young wide receiver from Princeton, Seth DeValve, who's doing fine with the Cleveland Browns. So they're all ready to go. We had a player, Taylor Heinicke, with Minnesota, who got hurt in the offseason. He'll be ready in 3 weeks. And, of course, Teddy Bridgewater just got hurt for some period of time. So Taylor will play in that Minnesota Vikings mix.
And if you wonder what I'm doing, by the way, this is also on YouTube Live on Zenny62 on YouTube for the first time. So I've got a double bill going here with Lee. So quite exciting to try this experiment here. This is really really coming along. It's Lee Steinberg Live with Zinni. And and so Lee, you're part once again of a grand experiment, basically. And
this looks like an Escher painting.
So I'm going to put this, now that I've liked that, anybody watching this can go to Zenny62 either on YouTube, or they can go to Zenny62 on my blog and also watch Lee live, as well as what is going to be uploaded on YouTube later. So,
or you can look at my own version of 3D, which
is... That was pretty cool, huh? You see, you're seeing yourself twice. So on balance, though, you've got now you're also recruiting and you also have an agent class, right? Give us an update on where you are right now.
So the Agent Academy is my attempt to try and bring along a new generation of ethical, principled, idealistic sports agents. People go to law school, they go to business school, sports management, and all across the country, the demand to be in the field of sports, either working for a team, a league, a conference, a college, a sports marketing firm, sports television, a union, sports PR is huge, and many people want to be sports agents. So what we try to do is offer specific skill training, how to recruit, how to negotiate, brand, market, deal with damage control, set up a charitable or community foundation, and take a group of young people, although some of them are professionals who are coming back because they'd like a career change, and work with them in a way that will train them and jumpstart their career. So we've done it now three times in Southern California, once in Berkeley, in Houston, in Dallas, in New York, in Philadelphia, in Ann Arbor, Michigan, in Chicago, and we'll probably continue because the demand has been great. But it's a way of mentoring the next generation of leaving a legacy.
Now, if I'm watching this and I want to get involved and take one of your courses, how do I do that?
Probably go to our website, which is steinbergsports.com, and then hit Agent Academy and sign up. Again, we've had people as young as 13 sign up as old as 70, and we're realistic about the challenges that getting involved in sports agentry would bring. There are probably 1,000 certified sports agents, and the competition level is very high, but it's very high in anything that's interesting to do in the world. So if you take young people on a campus, some of them want to be involved in high tech, some of them want to be involved in entertainment. A huge group wants to be involved in sports. So for any of those high glamour professions, the level of competition is going to be high. So we try to teach young people how to distinguish themselves, how to apply for a job. And instead of just turning a flat resume in, I tell the story of how someone submitted a Sports Illustrated issue. And we looked at it, and it looked like a regular SI with the same font and the same color.
Wow.
Only on the cover was a young man standing next to me, and the whole issue was trumpeting how we had hired him, and the fortunes of our firm had been incredibly enhanced. So it showed research, it showed mastery of physical skills, it showed creativity, it showed presentation, and we hired him. And someone else presented to us a Diet Dr. Pepper bottle, and I think I have it here, as a matter of
Oh,
fact.
okay.
So I'd spoken, and
Oh, wow.
I'd spoken at school, so he sends it in because he knew I liked Diet Dr. Pepper.
Yeah.
And yes, I know it's got all the awful sugar substitutes in it. So thank you, my health food friends. I'm trying to quit. So at any rate, it had a picture of this young man and I, but on the back it had the ingredients, which are innovation,
Maybe
100%,
push it,
passionate,
move it a little closer. There you go. Yeah.
passionate, 100%, hardworking, 100%, and
So
all the
Andrew
rest of
Woodward
it.
did that. That was Andrew.
Yes, so it showed incredible research into what we thought was important, and the rest of it, we hired him. So we try to show them how to distinguish themselves and to call themselves out from the masses to get noticed, because I might get 15,000 resumes in a given year, and so then the question is, how do you get yourself noticed? And how can you make yourself irreplaceable, non-modular, non-fungible?
Speaking of irreplaceable, non-mongible, and non-fungible, I'm going to switch to a topic that off camera we were talking about, but I want to hear your views on camera and live, and that's Colin Kaepernick. Your thoughts on Colin Kaepernick sitting for the national anthem and the firestorm of controversy it's caused. And by the way, since we're also on YouTube Live, I'm going to call up and put this on Twitter. So if you see yourself, you know, in kaleidoscope, bear with me for a moment, but you're still on. So go, go for it. Yeah.
I mean, I did go to Berkeley, so I know what psychedelics are. This is getting very trippy. My sense is that I've encouraged athletes over the years to get involved in expressing themselves politically. The prerequisite is they inform themselves on issues, political candidates, so they actually have a real understanding of what they're speaking of, and they're accurate and on point. And I think it's entirely appropriate for them to express themselves. And I think there are ways in which it helps them combat the concept of self-absorption and see themselves as citizens of the world, and it helps in their maturation process. And so we've seen, for example, in terms of the whole violence that's gripped our country, that athletes have come out and taken positions in terms of police killing unarmed citizens and also people who have attacked police. And we saw them do that on the ESPYs. We've seen them become part of town hall and all the rest of it. The problem in discussing Colin Kaepernick is that anytime you make a distinction, people think that you're attacking his message. And I'm not. I don't think it's appropriate to take that political discussion into a stadium itself and use, for example, the national anthem or the display of the flag as the way to express your feelings about racism, police shootings, or anything else. And the reason I don't is there are so many other ways for an athlete to express himself. He can write a column. He can give a speech. He can donate money to a cause that he thinks is important. He can go to a rally. He can march in a demonstration. He can call up a political figure and lobby. He can take out an ad. He's got social media in many different forms that he can express himself or herself on. There are innumerable ways to express opinions and also to put some real work into the effort of putting some punch behind just simply expressing an opinion. But people attend sports as a respite to get away from the problems of the real world. And let's take this to the end point. There are many fundamentalist Christian ballplayers, and part of their faith may be the fact that abortion is killing. And if they believe that strongly, they may believe that somehow America's condoning killing. And if they don't want to stand for the national anthem, or they want to display a picture of dead fetuses at a ball game because their conscience tells them that's the right way to go, why is that different than what Colin Kaepernick did? So now they go ahead and do that. Now, some people believe that a country that doesn't have more gun controls is allowing murder and mass murder to take place. So they go ahead and they use the athletic forum to do their demonstration, and they show pictures of young victims. And now all of a sudden, when you go to a game, it becomes very much like Sproul Plaza at Berkeley or any entry to a college campus where you have endless amounts of tables and demonstrations. And all of a sudden, the fact that sports is a unifying factor where people from disparate political, racial, gender, ethnic, every kind of background come together to get behind this non-political concept and enjoy themselves stops becoming that. I think I have a problem with that particular use because there's so many other ways to do it. And incidentally, it's not like this country has missed the fact that we've had a problem with violence by and against police. You can't turn on CNN or any local television affiliate without seeing the issue debated over and over and over again. This was not the first time this came to awareness. As a matter of fact, many, many, many athletes have spoken out on this at the ESPYs, on their own social pages. It's not like this was the first athlete to speak out. So I back the concept of athletes speaking out, just not at stadiums.
What do you think about the fact that he has us talking, though?
We were talking about it every day before. This issue's been in every newspaper. It's been front and center in this country for months, and it's been front and center for years. So the question is the action which is being taken. And when we talk about this issue, are we talking about the history of racial injustice in the United States? Are we talking about income inequality and the conditions in the inner city? Are we talking about the shootings of unarmed civilians by police? Are we talking about the issue of violence against police? And there's a whole interlocking set of issues here, all of which need to be addressed, and all of which I'm in favor of being addressed.
There seems
so, but the finger pointing that goes on in the end of this, where anyone who suggests, for example, a stadium might not be a great place is accused somehow of not understanding the issue. Please.
I have to ask, though, Cameron, it begs the question. There's another question. I think it's going to be more important than the one that I had on my mind, but that's the NFL. There are some media people that seem to be putting out the smoke signal that he's going to be in some kind of way released. What do you think?
I've made the same judgment, whether it was a gay player, whether it was someone accused of crimes and the rest of it. The NFL is a meritocracy. The most critical position is quarterback. It's a quarterback-centric lead. Colin Kaepernick can lead a team to the Super Bowl and has a few controversial opinions. Teams want him. So teams overlook amazing amounts of background situations if a player can help them win. So, you know, the real issue is, can he elevate his level of play in a critical situation to put a team on his back and take him to the Super Bowl?
Now, speaking of players elevating themselves and creating a high profile for themselves, we have Joey Bosa, who has signed what seems to be an amazing contract. I mean, should help us understand what just transpired earlier this week, Lee.
What's happened in terms of rookies, Zenny, is a major change. So for years and years and years, rookie contracts didn't have a cap. Negotiations didn't start until late June or July. Most players were late to training camp. There were no guarantees for skill or injury in contracts. along came the 2011 collective bargaining agreement, which had a very tight rookie wage scale. And what has happened after that is this: the whole way in which negotiating has been done changed. So teams made as their first offer basically all the money they could ever pay because of what that cap slot allowed as their first offer. So I'm sure that the Chargers offered Joey Bosa the maximum amount of bonus the slot could hold, which is around $17 million, and the maximum 4 years of salary, which is what every player has to sign for, and their option for a fifth year for a first rounder. They also offered him what we've seen in the last 5 years for the very first time: total guarantees over those 4 years for skill and injury. So the first 20 players in this year's first round got totally guaranteed contracts for skill and injury. Didn't happen for the whole history of football, but it's happening now. And those guarantees went on. So when you get down to Paxton Lynch, we got something in the fourth year, which was about a third of the money guaranteed. And they kept going into the second round, where the first couple of years for most of the players were guaranteed for skill and injury. Skill meaning that if the player gets cut, the team still has to pay him the remaining salaries. And injury meaning if the player in a football-related injury could no longer perform and his career was over, he still got paid the remaining salaries. So all that was there with Joey Bosa. He got into a fight over two very minor issues. One was the way in which the bonus was paid. So in the old days, the inflation rate was really, really high. I negotiated, you know, I've had 61 first rounders. There were years I negotiated where the inflation rate was 17%.
Wow.
So if a club decided they wanted to pay some of the signing bonus a year from now, that money was worth 17% less, or a dollar was worth 83 cents. So there was an issue there because they were paying us inflated or dollars that were worth much less. Today, the inflation rate's basically zero. So a dollar next year is probably worth about the same amount as it is now. What they offered him at the beginning, I don't know. What they were offering him by the end was 85% of it paid this year and 15% of it paid the year after. Not a major issue, but they got hung up over it. The second issue was what's called offset. Offset only occurs if in one of those years the player gets cut by the team. The team is paying him his salary just as if he was still on their roster. And the player now goes, being paid his whole salary by the Chargers, and gets a second offer. He now goes and plays for another team and he's making $800,000. And what the incumbent team, the Chargers in that case, is saying is, we don't want to pay you if your salary is $2 million, the whole $2 million. We want to pay you $2 million offset by the $800 you're making, or $1 million. So that was the fight. Now, the player at that point has already collected about, whatever, $20 million, and he's a bust. So that was what that fight was about. So these are not issues which hung up any other contract. And what made this an anomaly was the fact that it was the fastest signing rate for rookies ever. And basically all the rookies got signed very quickly because teams offered them the most they could offer them and the rookies accepted it. And so nobody else was out of training camp. I think the most was like a day or so. And so holdouts, which really hampered the NFL for years and years, have disappeared.
Wow.
So I don't know how they ultimately resolved it, but there was never much to resolve in the first place.
Does this set a precedent for the future in any kind of way, or is it just
No, again, it was an anomaly. I don't. The world will little note nor long remember this negotiation was pressure to do this. Not that every player doesn't need training camp, but for, a defensive lineman, if his job is to go sack the passer, if he shows up a couple of weeks late, his job is to still go sack the passer.
Now, shifting gears again, and we're coming back to the Olympics, and two people that have gotten into trouble with some shockingly different outcomes, as you, I think, will agree. Ryan Lochte and Hope Solo. And Ryan Lochte is just named to Dancing with the Stars. And yet Hope Solo suspended and her contract terminated. My question regarding Hope, first of all, is more of a fix-it question, because you and I have talked about, well, Tiger Woods, and you said Nate, everyone loves a comeback. Is that the case in Hope Solo's instance? Can she come back?
Part of the problem for the United States and the whole Solo situation is she probably is still the best goalie that exists out there for the U.S. to have a chance in women's soccer. There really isn't a replacement right now. They'll try to find one, but she really is the best. The problem she has is a history of different disputes. So she's had a chance to handle things differently in multiple different cases and didn't. And it's really sort of sad because she's tall and striking looking. She had every chance to be, she's got an awesome name for an athlete. She's had every chance to really become a household name and an American fixture, but there's been a repetition. I think the last series of quotes that she made go fundamentally to the whole concept of athletic competition. And to call someone a coward and say they won that way is not desirable. Personally, I think they came down a little too hard on her for that. It's post-game. We know that players get heated up. I think that yes, you want to make the point to her, these are not good comments, but just to ban her or kick her out, I thought was going too far. In the case of Ryan Lochte, his lying and the way he handled the entire thing by not coming forward, making an apology, making amends, whatever the facts were, and almost creating an international incident. And then the fact that the press ran it serially. Now, you can argue that the press could have handled it less dramatically, but here's the thing, Zenny. When an incident or a piece of film strikes the public imagination as either scandalous, interesting, intriguing, and it gets run over and over and over again, the cumulative effect of that is that in people's mind's eye, that athlete didn't have one bad night. The cumulative effect is that he's a lying, misbehaving so-and-so 24/7 all the time. Because you see it so many times. And instead of cutting it off, I mean, I ended up doing six separate appearances just on CNN in analysis of what was happening. And I did Fox and Inside Edition and all the rest of it because it was that hot an issue. Whether it should have been or not is another question. Whether it made too much of a mountain out of a molehill is another question. But it was. And he could have moved quickly to cut that off. Once again, in these cases, the lawyers intervene and they say, oh, he's got this massive amount of liability, we better make him be quiet and the rest of it. And I've looked at it with clients more as an issue of brand and damage control. The history in Brazil, when you have that type of vandalism, is that if you make a payment or do something, they don't prosecute. So I always argue with the lawyers, you know, here you have a guy accused of drunk driving. He certainly had alcohol in his system. You're trying to get him to be quiet so you can rearrange the facts. I'm trying to get him to come out and apologize. I think that puts you in a better position. And I certainly know that for my client, he needs to, as a role model, come out and apologize quickly and get this behind him because, you know, he was wrong. So you're taking this tight legal position, and I'm telling you that, you know, that if he has to go to alcohol classes, do the rest of it, he was wrong. Let's get out there. So this tension goes on back and forth between the attorney who wants the athlete to be quiet, to hide behind the attorney and these facts, and then the damage piles up and up and up.
I want to come back to something, mainly because also Hope's my personal friend, and ask, could she really come back? And here's why. And here's something that's all over social media now, that if she were a man, this wouldn't have happened to her this way. But what can she do to come back? Because she's quit CL Reign. She's went dark, which I personally think is a mistake. But, you know, I want to hear what you have to say, Lee. You know?
Oh, she absolutely could come back because we have never gotten to know Hope Solo or heard that much from her. And the truth is that she's being defined through domestic violence, driving with her husband in some car that was a van, through these comments. She could do an interview where she clarified, apologized, and explained who she was. She's a superb athlete. She's been representative of our country for years. We don't really know Hope Solo as a public. We just know the headlines and some of the comments she's made, which are unfortunate. But the point is that if you took the whole history of athletes' post-game comments, you know, they're often not pretty. People come back and apologize, and they make amends. So I don't know and don't want to criticize whoever's advising her, but it's females in female soccer who are disciplining her, I think.
Yeah, that's quite true. And finally, as we close, your thoughts on another subject I hear.
Early part of training camp. Now, we've tried to protect players, and as you know, I've been in the forefront of attempting to make the game safer from the specter of concussion. And one of the improvements that was put in is we eliminated hitting in the NFL in the offseason. So what happened is you have players who are in superb shape coming into training camp, not have hitting. When we ramp up that hitting, bam, you see a lot of season-ending injuries occur, and they're tough. Injuries are going to occur the minute you put players in games or in any situation. In the case of the Minnesota Viking quarterback, Bridgewater.
Teddy,
it was a non-contact injury.
Wow, yeah.
So that could occur anytime. So the real question is, should you have preseason games? And this controversy is going on. Do you need 4 weeks of preseason games? So one question is, how do you decide on a roster that has 90 people, but ultimately will have 53 with 47 active, who makes it and who doesn't? So some people think you can do that just through practice without the preseason games. And do you need the preseason games? So I think you can take a look at all those things. I will just tell you that anytime you have bodies hit, you have an equal chance of injury. So if you're going to play preseason games, you're going to have people get hit. But if you're going to have practice with hitting, you're going to have people that get injured also. So the reality is that a football game where there's hitting is like a traffic accident. So the human body, I think God in his infinite wisdom was not sitting there in heaven saying, now I'm going to design a body, and the way I'm going to ensure its health is to have the fittest members of the human species slamming against each other at awkward angles at high rates of speed, you know, with high G-force, and that's how we're going to keep people healthy.
Well, Lee, this has been fantastic, and next time I try the live stream as an experiment to see how it works, and it works. So the next time we get together, I'll actually promote the live stream and do the Skype call at the same time. And that way, and then I can get the comments, because there are people rolling up with things, but you know, I can have them ask questions, you know, as we go along, which I think would be pretty interesting.
Well, yeah, and then you know, we could do this in public, see, so we could have, like, actual live people.
Yeah.
They could walk up and ask questions, and then we could have mirrors surround it, so we could have multiple dimensions. You know,
well, you know what? You know what? You know, I could have. Hey, you.
Asleep.
No, you know, I want to bring back the John McLaughlin style. I'll say, what say you?